God bless you. This morning, we just want to give thanks to God for his goodness and how God has moved among us. And the spirit of worship has been wonderful this morning. Amen. We just believe that God is bringing us closer and closer to a major breakthrough. So we don't want those that's in prayer to slack up, because I can feel the momentum building. Amen. I can feel the momentum building. So you want to support the prayer Monday night, Sunday morning. You can, even on Wednesday night, we spend time in prayer. So we just want you to know that God is giving us a breakthrough in prayer. I'm going to open my mouth and scream and holler and release myself, sing in the spirit, pray in the spirit, run in the spirit. I mean, whatever the Lord tells me to do. Amen. I just really enjoy worshiping the Lord in spirit and in truth. Amen. I just want to give a little testimony concerning something we were facing in terms of the air conditioning unit. We had kind of diagnosed it a couple of weeks ago as being a compressor was had been blown out, was gone, $1,800. And so I knew that we already owed the heat and air people money, so I wasn't that excited about trying to appeal to you to get an $1,800 compressor. So we just said, well, we'll just go with three units. This one here was working. Y'all can tell this one, the two in the back were working, but this one on this side was not working. It hasn't been working in the last two or three weeks. So what happened was that we called the heat and air man out. We thought we had two extra air conditioners back here that was given to us. And you know, that's a blessing, because the unit that was bad in the back building, the heat and air man found someone that he knew that had some extra units that they were going to give away, and he gave us, I believe it was three units. And these are big units that if you buy them new, they would be around $2,000. He gave us, I think, three. So he put one in the back building. So all of the units in the back building are working. And then we have two extra over here in this room over here. So we thought we would just snatch the bad unit out over here and put one of the spares we had back here. And when the air and heat man came out, he said that I can't do that, because those you have back here are single phase and these are three phase. He said it won't work. So he said that the only thing I can suggest is an $1,800 compressor. And he said, well, let me check that again. You know, I don't know whether God worked a miracle in the last 3 weeks, but he checked it out, and the unit, it wasn't a compressor. It was a little old contact, a little old wire or something, which caused probably less than what, brother? Al, 50? Less than $50. So he said, that's all you need. The compressor is all right. I believe somebody been praying for that compressor. God turned things around. Hallelujah. So we have all of the units working in the auditorium. Doesn't it feel a little better? Amen. Praise God. And all of them are working in the back building. Oh, that saved the church several thousand dollars. Isn't God good? And I believe a whole lot of it is because of us rejoicing. Scripture says, rejoice evermore. In everything. Hey, when it seems like you're defeated, you're going under. There's no way out, no solution to whatever you're facing. The scripture says, in the midst of your adversity, rejoice, 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 rejoice. Amen. I'm almost tempted this morning to have a rejoicing session, and so we can just pay off the balance of what we owe, amen, on all this other stuff. Amen. How many believe rejoicing will work? Amen. So I'm saying, well, I don't know about that. All right. Isn't God good? Isn't God good? All right. We just want to lay the foundation for something that we're going to be sharing. I'm going to just have a word of prayer, and I'm going to announce my fourth key to stay in focus. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for the work that you have begun in us. We thank you, Lord, that you are working. You are at work. You are working your will and the due of the ability to do your good pleasure. Father, we give you praise. We give you the glory. In Jesus' name, the name above every name. Everybody just say, in the name of Jesus. They ministered this morning about the name of Jesus. He stayed on that Jesus. Amen. That Jesus thing. Amen. That was wonderful. Amen. That was a blessing. The six keys that we have shared to this point were, number one, self-restraint or self-discipline. Six keys to stay in focus spiritually. I think this is important because a whole lot of people are getting off track. A whole lot of people are having challenges. And if they could employ these particular disciplines, it could really help to keep them on the right path. And the first key was self-restraint or self-discipline. Everybody just say self-restraint or self-discipline. How many believe that you have to restrain your flesh? If you don't restrain it, you'll just go wild. Amen. Paul said, they of the circumcision, this is Philippians 3:3, they worship God in the Spirit, and they rejoice in Jesus Christ, and they have no confidence in the flesh. Amen. That's the key to staying focused, worshiping God in spirit, and rejoicing in Jesus Christ, and having no confidence in your flesh. Amen. How many believe that you can't have any confidence in your flesh? Okay. All right. So that was the first key we mentioned. The second one was persistent in prayer and thanksgiving. Everybody just said persistent in prayer and thanksgiving. Amen. That is the motivation behind all that we do in prayer. Sometimes it seems like we just seem so foolish, and sometimes people scream. People understand that Monday night prayer was just a washout.
It was a washout.
They say that Brother Rod Dennis and Sister Dorothy, amen, yeah, prayed until the power of the Lord came in. Amen. So I don't know if y'all amen. Missing all of this. My God, y'all missing.
Amen.
Amen. A whole lot. Amen. God uses Brother Travis. Oh, he's been committed and faithful long time. Amen. Amen. Been running for Jesus a long time now, Brother Travis, and you ain't got tired yet. Amen. We thank God for his leadership because he's been very steady, very committed, very faithful. And he prays in the Spirit and does all that he can to keep the spirit of prayer alive. Pastor Hill doesn't show up sometime. Amen. Pastor Hill don't feel like showing up every time. Amen. But things go on just as if I was there. Yeah, Brother Rod Dennis and Brother Wayne. Brother Wayne has been a source of strength. And, oh, amen. He just seemed like his presence. I don't know what's happening to Brother Wayne, but he's a man that's really pushing this rejoicing thing.
Amen.
And praising God and worshiping God. His teachings have just been really wonderful. The third key we mentioned is to stay humble. And we mentioned several things that help you to understand what being humble, how many say, I want to know what being humble means. I'm just going to read it off to you briefly so that you can understand exactly what humility entails. Relying on God rather than trusting in yourself. We have scriptures for all of that, but we've been over them. Number two, not thinking more highly than you ought to think. Number three, not desirous of vain glory. Number four is to retire and withdraw from your way and yield to God's way. And number five, a deep sense of need, realizing you are lean, lanky, lacking, bankrupt, poverty-stricken, and you need God very bad. Amen. A deep sense of need. Everybody just say a deep sense of need. And number six, humility is possessing a servant's heart, an attitude, a submissive spirit, being completely devoted to the master's interests, focusing mainly on what pleases and bring honor to God. That's kind of give you a gist. Everybody just say, he's giving us a gist of what staying humble is all about. Scripture says the disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord. And Jesus mentioned about, for even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. So that's what being a servant or having a servant's heart is like. Jesus said, for I do always those things that please him. Amen. But it's very rare that you find a person with a servant's heart, completely devoted over to the master's interest. Amen. Amen. I'm not getting no amens now. Amen. But the greatest of you, Bible says, he that seeks to be the greatest shall be what? The servant of all. How you like that?
Amen.
Amen. Okay. Now the fourth point I want to give you is that this is very significant. I want you to get ready for this one. Amen. It's allowing the Holy Spirit. Everybody say, allowing the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm trying to turn to the area that I want to. Allowing the Holy Spirit to show me the end result of what God wants me to be or do. Allowing the Holy Spirit to show me the end result of what God wants me to be or what God wants me to do. Okay, and all of that is found in the Word of God. What God wants me to be or what God wants me to do. That's very, very important because it's God's will for man to see the end results from the beginning. Seeing the end results from the beginning will serve as a compass for your life. Seeing the end results from the beginning will serve as a compass for your life. Now, if I could give you an illustration, I couldn't give you any better illustration of Abraham. I believe when God took Abraham out, and God had promised him that he would make of him a great nation, and through him all of the seed of the earth would be blessed. All of the nations of the earth would be blessed. God took him out and showed him, amen, all of the stars in the firmament. And then he showed him the sand of the sea. And he said, this is exactly what your seed will be like. He saw, because God had what? He showed him through the stars. He says, your seed is going to be as numerous as the stars of heaven. So he got the picture, the end results of what God wanted him to be, and the end results of God, what God was going to do through him. And how many believe that if Joseph hadn't had that vision of, remember the vision of the dream of the tares, and all of those tares were bowing down to him. He saw his life history from that dream, even at the beginning of his life. He knew that one day that he would be reigning and ruling over his entire family, and that he would be a person that will be governing and in power over the nation of Egypt. It was a vision, a dream that he saw, the end results of what God was eventually going to do through him. Now, if Joseph hadn't seen all of that, if he hadn't seen the end before the beginning, I don't think that he could have been so composed, so faithful, and so committed to who's that, Potiphar, and then after he served Potiphar for 10 years, and then Potiphar's wife lied on him. He ended up in what? Prison. And he was in prison for a few years, and he kept being promoted. He was promoted in Potiphar's house. He was promoted in prison until he was what? Amen. He was the manager of the prison. I mean, he was over the prison and all the prisons. Amen. And in prison, he had the opportunity to interpret those dreams, and those dreams that he interpreted was the dreams that released him and brought him before Pharaoh, and he was able to interpret Pharaoh's dream, and the rest was history. Now, I don't believe that he could have been so comfortable in those chains. He was in chain or iron chain for a while. I mean, he was just a regular prisoner before he was promoted. He didn't go from Potiphar's house to prison, amen, and just got promoted instantly. But he had to suffer a while he was, amen, praise God, while God was working until the word of the Lord came. He had to suffer. But it's a whole lot easier when you're going through trials and you know exactly how it's going to end. It's a lot easier. And I remember years ago when God spoke to me. I was going to Rhema, and I was doing a 30-day consecration. I mean, this was a real fast. And I had never dreamed that God would ever use me for writing books and sharing with ministers all over the nation. And God spoke to me while I was on that 30-day consecration, and he began to show me the end results of, well, this is what he told me. He said, all of the years you've been sharing Bible lessons on a 101, going into homes, dealing with drug addicts, and all of the challenges that you have had as a pastor, he said that I want you to put it in some kind of order or form, and begin to share the things that you have shared with the hundreds and, you know, hundreds of people that you have ministered these lessons to, and I want you to just put it in a format that you can share with ministers and ministries all across the nation. And in prayer, God showed me the end results of obeying him and putting this material in a form where I could share it with hundreds and hundreds of pastors. Amen. Sometimes y'all don't understand that sometimes you can see a whole lot more on your knees than you can standing up. How many can say praise the Lord? Amen. So being able to see the end results of what God wants you to be or what God wants you to do is something that you actually want to see, want to know, and you can know it. Scripture says, eye has unseen, neither ear has heard. Neither has it entered into the heart of men the things that God has prepared for them that love him. Amen. That's found in 1 Corinthians. Amen. That scripture just jumped out at me. Amen. Somebody found that for me. Eye hasn't seen, but neither ear has heard, neither has it entered into the heart of men the things that God has prepared for them that love him. Amen. That's 1 Corinthians 2:9. But as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But verse 10 says, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. That is important. God has revealed them by his Spirit. So we can know the things that God has prepared for us. We can know the end results of the things that God wants to do through us and for us, and who we're to be, and what we're to do. We can know the end results from the beginning. Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right. Now that is very important for you to know the end results from the beginning, because it does a whole lot of things. I just want, the first thing I mentioned, it serves as a compass for your life. In other words, it's the thing that keeps you on track. Sometimes I am almost at the point of giving in and giving up. Amen. Going through all that you have to deal with as a pastor, all the frustrations, all of the disrespect, and all of the disobedience and contention and all this. Amen. You know how folks are. Y'all know how we are. Amen. You have to go through a lot. A whole lot. A whole lot. And sometimes you have to bite your tongue to keep from saying the wrong thing. And sometimes you have to pray. Amen. Before you act, before you do, or before you say. Pray before you say. Amen. How many understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
One thing that I know that probably not a month goes by, and some, you know, you are ready to throw in the towel. Amen. You know, I've put a whole lot of time to my mind. Amen. I said, let them make it the best they can. Let them, hallelujah, let them find someone else that will work for what I'm working for. Amen. Sometimes you feel like throwing it in, throwing everything. Amen. Just throwing it in the towel. Amen. But the thing about it, when you think about throwing it in the towel and leaving such sweet people, look how sweet y'all look at that. My God. Think about all these smiley, sweet, some of y'all cook me food. Amen. Do go out of the way, do special things. And I said, man, how can I turn my back on people that are so nice? But sometimes you just get upset. Amen. That's just all right. Don't you ever get upset? So I really got a real nice, pleasant face. See, like she did. I can ask Mother Wendell. The real Sister Irene. All right. It would be good. So that I would be just a pleasant person. But When I look at the end results of what God has shown me, I can't afford to give up. I can't afford it. Amen. God told me that we will be reaching hundreds and hundreds of pastors. And it's really amazing the respect that we have won from pastors and bishops all over this country. I can call it numerous of bishops, and all they would have is just respect. And I was calling some of the pastors that I had met in North Carolina, met over probably close to 100 of them when we were there 4 or 5 years ago. And they look up to me like I'm somebody important. I said, how in the world can they see me as being important? And then whenever I tell them, you know, they believe it, they'll accept it. I don't have to prove nothing. They just take me at my word.